The COVID-19 vaccines, pregnancy, breastfeeding, and infertility. We're talking about each one of those subjects because you requested it. Let's bring in the special guest, Mama Dr. Jones. Welcome to the channel. Today, I'd like to talk with you specifically surrounding the COVID-19 vaccines and their effects on pregnancy, breastfeeding, and infertility. Three subjects that you're an absolute expert on. I'm a patient. I walk into your office. Hey, Dr. Jones. I am pregnant. Should I get the vaccine? What's your response?
This is not a yes or no answer for any of my patients. This is, all right, I'm so glad that you asked that. Let's sit down and let's talk about it. We know that this vaccine is safe and effective in adults at preventing severe COVID symptoms. We know that it is probably effective in pregnant people as well because they generally rate pretty similarly as far as safety and effectiveness of non-live vaccines, which this is not a live vaccine. What we don't know is what is the evidence of fetal safety or fetal harm. We can't tell you that. We can talk about the biologic plausibility, meaning is it likely to cause harm to a fetus? And I would say that is pretty unlikely, but I can't tell you for sure because I don't have that data. At the end of the day, I think it's really important to say we don't have any reason to think that this would be harmful. And we know that COVID-19 is harmful in people who are pregnant and does increase rates of pregnancy complications.
When we were doing the initial research on COVID-19 and vaccines, we did not include pregnant patients. Do you think that was the right move, not including pregnant patients in the initial research?
I don't, and we've been talking about this as obstetricians since before the trials got started. Like, please do not exclude people who are pregnant. This will cause major issues with uptake and with also how we counsel our patients when we get the vaccine available. But now here we are with no way to really have specific data to give to our patients, but still in a position where it's really important that we talk about it.
You may have two patients that come to your office. One patient does not have to leave the home and faces a lower risk of contracting COVID because of their interactions. They live in a single generational household, don't have to leave the house, do not have to work, are financially stable. They may face one decision and one recommendation when it comes to getting the vaccine as a pregnant person. And the second patient, who either needs to continue working, lives in a multi-generation household, has multiple people in their homes who constantly leave and come back, and as a result faces higher risk, they may make a different decision, and both could be the right decision for those patients.
Absolutely, and I think you really hit on a perfect point there is, whatever decision you make, if it is made with counseling from your physician or your advanced practice provider, whoever's taking care of you and your baby, it is the right decision. And I'm here to provide all that information to help you initiate that conversation and feel empowered to ask those questions. But there's not a right or wrong answer here. This is very individual.
This individual decision really breaks down to the fact that initial research did not include pregnant patients. Our intuition and our logic and our experience says likely you will be protected the same, likely you will be safe, but we cannot say that with the same certainty we say the 95% protection. When it comes to knowing the other side of that equation is, we can tell you how dangerous COVID is. We can tell you how dangerous it is for you as a pregnant patient, that it is more dangerous than the average person. So now you have to deal with this unknown, which we don't have the evidence for, but you have some expert opinion, with the known of how serious COVID is, and you really have to weigh those two things. My problem occurs with those who have no logical, biological, plausible reasons for saying it's dangerous, putting out information as if it's fact or proven by some mechanism, and scaring the general public unnecessarily. Have you seen examples of that?
Something I saw that I really fought back against and feel like we made some very good change in was SMFM, which is the High Risk Pregnancy Society, ACOG, which is Pregnancy and Gynecology. All of these organizations came out and said, people who are pregnant deserve this choice. You can't take away an adult person's autonomy to choose the vaccination simply because we don't have fetal data. This should be an autonomous decision. And so I really laid into that from the beginning, and most of those organizations have been extremely supportive of that. But what we saw was people going into, you know, their place that's providing the vaccine, their hospital or health department or whatever, and being told, you can't get the vaccine because you're pregnant. And this is essentially taking that autonomy away from the pregnant person, despite the fact that every major medical organization in the United States, including ACIP and the CDC, has said they deserve that choice, especially in a high-risk situation where you're at the bedside with people who have COVID. So that's a really important point as well.
I think there are a couple of instances that we should definitely talk about to perhaps reassure the general public of why it is what we're saying. There have been several examples, even physician colleagues of you and I, who have gotten the vaccine and are actively pregnant.
Absolutely. I have several pregnant obstetrician friends who I have talked to about this. I haven't found a single obstetrician who has been pregnant and refused a vaccine because we all feel like the most likely scenario is that it is safer to receive the vaccine than to get COVID in pregnancy. If I were pregnant, that's what I would choose 100% after knowing all that I know. We're really practicing what we preach in that area, and I think that can make a huge difference in public education.
Yeah, leading by example as physicians has been huge with this hashtag this is our shot movement, and I hope we continue to do that. Have you seen in the research, and this is something I came across, that there were in fact some patients in the research who did not know that they were pregnant because pregnancy at times is unpredictable, that became pregnant, got the vaccines, and still did fine?
Yes, so we don't have a whole lot of information on that subset of the people in the trials yet. And so far there have been no reported bad outcomes related to the vaccine in those people who unintentionally got pregnant either between the doses or after one of the doses.
Similar subject, you have a patient who was recently pregnant and is now breastfeeding. Are there any risks to getting the vaccine and continue breastfeeding?
You know, we're kind of end up in the same situation, although in this one, I would say I have even less concern because there's really no way biologically that an mRNA vaccine should be causing problems through breast milk. If anything, we would expect that the maternal antibody transfer through the breast milk would be beneficial to the breastfeeding baby. So I think that this is the same situation. Obviously, we don't have direct data and we're gathering that. There are ongoing trials right now for this, but we, I think, can pretty safely say there's no biologic plausibility to any theory that it would be dangerous to continue breastfeeding. Again, this is based on past experience and on just looking at data from other things, so that could change. We could find something different, but I wouldn't hesitate to get the vaccination while breastfeeding at this point.
When it comes to making a decision of whether to get the vaccine when you're breastfeeding, we have to admit it is a harder decision than if you're a person who's not pregnant, who's not breastfeeding, because there is a layer of unknown. But it doesn't mean that it should 100% stray you away from getting the vaccine. Why? Because you have to still weigh that unknown against the known of how dangerous COVID-19 is. So while there are unknowns, there are also still very good reasons as to why you should be getting the vaccine. And I think that's well heard in your recommendation that you just said.
And I want to add one more thing is something I hear often is people say, well, we don't know the long-term effects of the vaccine. And to that, I would say, we don't know the long-term effects of COVID-19 either, even in kids who get it, who maybe don't have severe symptoms. And if we look historically, there are so many more viral illnesses that can cause long-term problems than any vaccination that we've seen to cause a long-term problem.
One of the major questions that I see in the comment section when I did my first vaccination video, and it continues to this day, is the conversation surrounding the vaccine and infertility moving forward. What are the claims that you have heard, and do you have any idea how they started?
This essentially came from a blog post that was posted about, quote, the head of Pfizer research or former head of Pfizer research has concerns about sterility from COVID-19 vaccination. And if you really dive into where these concerns come from, it's some scientists kind of thinking out loud on a Reddit thread. Now, importantly, we should consider this. These are smart people. We should look into it. We should never just dismiss things like that. But the second half of that is, once we look into it, their claim is that this is a genetic sequence in the spike protein, which is the part of the COVID-19 or SARS-CoV-2 virus that allows it to get into your respiratory system. And they say it's genetically similar to the protein syncytin 1. This is the protein that helps your body create a healthy placenta in the embryo. And that happens at about 8 or 9 weeks. So we run into our first issue there is that if this was gonna cross-react, antibodies to syncytin 1 wouldn't even cause infertility. They would cause miscarriage. And that doesn't make sense because you are pregnant for at least 8 or 9 weeks before the placenta is actually working. So syncytin 1 in the placenta not working will cause the pregnancy to fail, not to never exist. And then the second half of that is the antibodies when you get the vaccination are the same as if you had COVID-19. They're the same antibody against the same genetic sequence in the spike protein. So we should be seeing then an increase in early miscarriage in people who had COVID-19 if there was any plausibility to these claims. And we haven't really seen that play out in the literature yet. Again, that could change. I think it's highly unlikely that we'd see that. And then you also brought up earlier the point about some people got pregnant during the trials. These were people who were told, be on contraception, please don't get pregnant, do everything you can to avoid pregnancy, and we still had surprise pregnancies in the trials. That would make very little sense if this is truly causing infertility.
All such great points arguing against it. The weakness that we face here is our humility and our dedication to honest reporting of facts, right? Because if we wanted to, we could lean so heavily on our expert opinion and just say this is nonsense, just like how people who are I know all experts or are very anti-vaccination, they present their theories as if they're facts. They are not. Even when we discuss infertility now, you rightfully say more research needs to be done. This is what we think thus far. We don't have perfect evidence for it yet. That level of humility should inspire you at home to understand that we're trying to give you the best with what we have, as opposed to convince you of some illogical explanation, which is happening. Do not let the folks who are trying to misguide you, who are trying to become popular, who are trying to spread misinformation to thrive, because they're not following logic. There's no humility in their arguments. And I want you to pay attention to Dr. Jones' humility, because it's so important for scientists to have good skepticism and humility. And I think she expressed all of those in answering your three most common questions when it comes to pregnancy, breastfeeding, and infertility with the COVID-19 vaccines. Thank you so much for all of you who are watching. Mama Dr. Jones, where can they follow you? Where can they see more of your content?
I am Mama Dr. Jones on every platform imaginable, probably too many social platforms, but you can find me in all those places.
Last word, I want you to leave the viewers with what you believe to be the most important part of this conversation.
I think the most important part of this conversation is we are giving you information to empower you to have a discussion with your healthcare provider. Whatever questions you have, this should be a jumping point so that you have that information to talk with them about.
We talk COVID vaccine, now check out a day in the life of a doctor, me, during COVID-19. See what a true COVID-19 unit looks like. Click here, check it out, and as always, stay happy and healthy.